summer, many people grow vegetable and flower gardens or appreciate the work of others by buying produce from roadside stands and farmers markets. All our readings today embrace one of God's smallest but most common miracles as a metaphor: the seed and its cycle and all that it stands for. Isaiah reminds us that just as God waters the earth and cares for it so that seeds may grow, so the word of God will come and not return to God until it has borne fruit. Psalm 65 describes the cycle of growth and personifies fields that shout for joy. Romans has creation groaning in labor pains as it waits for its seed to come to fruition, redemption of the body. Similarly, Jesus teaches the crowds by using the parable of the sower and the seed.
Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, to prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries, let us call to mind our sins. Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, just as from the heavens the rain and snow come down and do not return there till they have watered the earth, making it fruitful and fertile, giving seed to the one who sows and bread to the one who eats, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. My word shall not return to me void, but shall do my will, achieving the end for which I sent it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Jesus went out of the house and sat down by the sea. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat down. And the whole crowd stood along the shore. And he spoke to them at length in parables, saying, a sower went out to sow. As he sowed, some seed fell on the path, and birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky ground, where it had little soil. It sprang up at once because the soil was not deep. And when the sun rose, it was scorched, and it withered for lack of root. Some seed fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it. But some seed fell on rich soil and produced fruit, 100, 60, or 30-fold. Whoever has ears, ought to hear. The disciples approached him and said, why do you speak to them in parables? He said to them in reply, because knowledge of the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven has been granted to you, but to them it has not been granted. To anyone who has, more will be given, and he will grow rich. From anyone who has not, even what he has will be taken away. This is why I speak to them in parables. Because they look, but they do not see and hear, but do not listen or understand. Isaiah's prophecy is fulfilled in them, which says, you shall indeed hear, but not understand. You shall indeed look, but never see. Gross is the heart of his people. They will hardly hear with their ears. They have closed their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their hearts, and be converted, and I heal them. But blessed are your eyes, because they see, your ears, because they hear. Amen, I say to you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see, but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, but did not hear it. Hear then the parable of the sower. The seed sown on the path is the one who hears the word of the kingdom without understanding it, and the evil one comes and steals away what was sown in his heart. The seed sown on rocky ground is the one who hears the word and receives it at once with joy. But he has no root and lasts only for a time. When some tribulation or persecution comes because of the word, he immediately falls away. The seed sown among the thorns is the one who hears the word. But then worldly anxiety and the lure of riches choke the word. It bears no fruit. But the seed sown on rich soil is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields 100, 60, or 30-fold. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
We are so often told that we have just a few years to save the world, that if we do not do anything, catastrophe will happen to our planet, and therefore we must take steps. Now, at the beginning of this year, so long ago, we were told, for example, that some of these steps we should take were to ban straws from restaurants. They're bad for the environment. Or hotels should no longer stock those little bitty bottles of soap and shampoo. Those were bad for the environment. Or if you went to the grocery store, you should use a reusable bag.
That would be better for the environment. Well, things have changed. It's amazing what a few months and a whole new situation will bring about. Straws, they're back in stock. Little bitty bottles of shampoo and soap, you can bet they'll be there. Which is good, because I'm running low. Reusable bags in the grocery store? Well, I just saw over at the Jewel, they have a sign. No reusable bags, single-use plastic only. I suppose we found out that there are more important things. Yet, we need to keep in mind as Christians what is truly the most important thing. And the most important thing we have to keep in mind is that catastrophe for this world is not about to occur. It already has occurred. Catastrophe for our world occurred long ago when we human beings turned away from God, when we rebelled against God, when we sinned against God. That was a catastrophe not only for those particular human beings, not only for the human race in general, but indeed for all the creation that the human race was meant to oversee and to be stewards of. That was a catastrophe. And the worst part about this catastrophe that occurred, which separated not only we human beings from God, but also created a break between God and his creation in general, the worst part of it was it could not be healed by any action you or I or any other human being or human beings in general could ever undertake. As long as we were thinking about human actions, it was a permanent break, a permanent catastrophe. How fortunate for all of us. How fortunate for the world that God himself came to heal this catastrophe, to heal this break, to restore what was broken. Jesus Christ, the Word of God, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, came amongst us, walked amongst us, taught us, suffered for us upon the cross, died for us, that we might be restored to God, that our sins might be forgiven, and that the break which occurred between us human beings and God might be healed. And with our healing, with our restoration, comes about the restoration of the world in general. It is a marvel. Catastrophe occurred, catastrophe averted, catastrophe healed and made even better than before. Yet we recognize as Christians that we are still waiting for the complete restoration, the complete fulfillment of God's plan. The victory of God's plan has already occurred. It occurred when Jesus Christ rose from the dead. Yet we wait, as St. Paul points out in the second reading today, we wait along with the world for the completedness, the fulfillment in its totality of Christ's victory. St. Paul writes that the world is waiting for this moment. So should we. Waiting for the moment of Christ returning in glory, when everything will be made right, everything will be made perfect. We know it will occur. We have no doubts on this. But we wait for that moment when it'll all be visible to every one of us. We might ask ourselves, what can we do? What should we do? so that we might enjoy this victory, that we might look forward, not with disappointment or fear the coming of the Lord in glory, but with hope for the coming of the Lord in glory. What we should do is to follow the teachings of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We can begin with the two greatest commandments that he taught us: to love the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our strength, with all our mind, and to love our neighbor as ourselves. The two greatest commandments that he taught. This is the beginning of the Christian life right here, to do these two things. We recall how elsewhere in the gospel, a young man approached Jesus and asked him, "Lord, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And that is what Jesus Christ told him, those two things. And then the young man said, "Lord, I have done this since my youth." The Lord looked upon him, it is said in the gospel, and told him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." Since we recall that close connection between us as human beings and that which we steward, the earth and the creation around us, the closer we come through the grace of God and our cooperation with that grace to being near the kingdom of God, so too all of creation around us draws closer to the kingdom of God. You ask what we can do for our world. You ask what we can do for the creation around us. The answer is be holy. The answer is to follow the commandments and the teachings of our Lord. Far more than not using straws or not using little bottles of soap. Far better is to follow the teaching of our Lord and Savior. For that brings about salvation, not only for yourselves, but for the whole world. That brings about the moment of the glory of the kingdom of God. And that is something we look forward to with hope and anticipation. And that is something whose circumstances will never change. We all recognize that this pandemic changed the circumstances and thrust aside things that people had been talking about into the back burner that nobody even really recalls that people were talking about it 6 months ago. But salvation, eternal life, the glory of the kingdom of God, these things last. And these things we should strive to hold on to.
Please stand, and together, let us profess our faith.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God of God, life of God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made.
our prayers and our needs before our Heavenly Father.
We pray for openness in the church to God's generous gift of life-giving word. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for an end to hunger throughout the world through a generous sharing of planting and harvesting from every nation. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for those who suffer in the heat, for those who endure storms, fires, and floods, and for all who respond to their needs with generous hearts. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for migrant workers and for immigrants as they strive for a better life for themselves and for their families. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the health and safety of all our communities as we continue to reopen in the wake of the pandemic. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for our ailing brothers and sisters, including those on our bulletin prayer list who have asked for our prayers. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the intentions of this man, Frank Kubicini, and Marshall and Betty Bracchio. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all the prayers that we hold in the silence of our hearts, for all our intentions spoken and unspoken. Let us pray to the Lord.
are indeed holy, O Lord, and the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Body of Christ. Take it.
Sorry.
It's okay. The body of Christ. The body of Christ.
Amen.
The body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ. Body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ. Great day. The body of Christ.
The
body of Christ.
Amen.
Body of Christ.
Body of Christ.
body of Christ. The body of Christ.
The body of Christ.
Body of Christ.
Body of Christ.
Body of Christ. Body of Christ.
Body of Christ.
The body of Christ.
Body of Christ. Body of Christ.
The body of Christ.
The body of Christ.
Body of Christ.
Let us pray. Having consumed these gifts, we pray, O Lord, that by our participation in this mystery, its saving effects upon us may grow through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I have two brief announcements. With those persons who are volunteering to help clean the church after Mass, please meet in the middle of the church following the end of Mass. Also, those persons who are considering joining those volunteers, please volunteer. We are hoping to form two separate teams for each Mass on the weekend so that, well, we have a bit of a rotation among those volunteering to help out. And secondly, I want to offer my congratulations to the young lady who made her first communion today.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your lives.
Thanks.